I lifted the lid and saw inside some manky old slippers and cap, photographs, sepia photographs, some of them rotting, a very old smell of leather that had gone wrong. And I realised this was something a bit sort of holy. And as an 8-year-old kid, I like slammed the lid and ran up to see my grandmother, Doris. And in that box, later, when my mother inherited it, we found a lot of stuff. And I'm going to show you the box, hopefully, when we go through. So that's the box. And by the way, the valise, the suitcase he had. This has been airtight for 80 years. Inside, this is the kind of stuff we found. Let me just keep putting that there. Oh, sorry, I've gone too far. Doesn't matter. We found all sorts of artifacts. I will go back because they're just kind of fun. Come closer to you. Okay, I'll come closer here and try it again. If not, we'll just do forwards. We found his shaving brush, his whistle, his knife, his fishing reel. We found all sorts of things. But we also found, as that last slide showed, I'm going to go back one.
It's all right. You can give me the nod.
Okay, I'll give you the nod. We found 772 letters between my grandfather and my grandmother, written between 1916 and 1918. So they wrote to each other pretty much every single day. Worked out it was about 500,000 words of writing. There were his diaries, there were trench maps, aerial photographs, orders, plenty of souvenirs, German hand grenade, his pistol, his cap, badges, medals. Everything to do with his life had been put in the ammo box, lid shut on it, and my grandmother shut the lid on the life and the marriage that they had, short as it was. Now, George Ammann, the next slide, just to tell you where he got his name from, he was, his father was Swiss and had come to Britain in 1900 to teach modern languages in Britain at the King Edward's School in Bath. He was a professor of modern languages. His mother was Irish from Drogheda, and they met somewhere, I think in Middlesbrough in the north of England, and he was nationalized British, and they had three kids. Bubby had an older brother and an older sister. Older brother went in the Navy. Classical in those times was the oldest brother went in the Navy. Usually the second son went in the army, and the third son went into the church. That was the way it was done in those Edwardian days. He went into went to school, was in the OTC, left school at 16, became a bank clerk. He then joined the yeomanry in Somerset, and then his bank moved him to Manchester, where he became an assistant bank manager at the National Provincial Bank in Manchester. And he was a part-time soldier there with the Duke of Lancaster's own yeomanry. They're a bit infamous because they were the famous Peterloo Massacre regiment of yeomanry, who slaughtered British people in Manchester streets in about 60 years before. As a private, in the next slide, he went to Egypt. This was the first regiment, the Duke of Lancaster's own yeomanry. They were the first regiment to go overseas. They went over as a cavalry regiment to defend the Suez Canal and let the regular army come back to the Western Front in France. So by September 1914, he was, let's have a look in the next slide, he was in Egypt with his men, with their pit helmets, his horses. He rode against the Turks when the Turks tried to take the Suez Canal in February 1915. He went to officer school in Egypt and came out as a lieutenant. And unfortunately, he was ill twice. It may have been fortunate for him because as an officer, he was sent to join the Munster Fusiliers who went to Gallipoli, and he didn't get to go because he had scarlet fever and then he had mumps. So he spent a lot of time in hospital. While he was in hospital, he had two love affairs. I've got the details on those, and in my book, some of the names have to be changed. One of them, by the way, the next slide is, we'll see. Well, he, on the way out to Egypt, he said to his fiancée, "This war will last longer than Christmas, whatever the papers say. I'm no doubt we shall beat the Boche, but when that will be and who will come back to the dear old country is not to be revealed for some time. Only God knows, and he's not telling. I believe we must hold our engagement, and you, dear girl, must be free to plan your life without this soldier man. I feel strongly that war now comes before love." So that was his going in position to the war. So she sent his engagement ring back. By the way, later on he used the same engagement ring to my grandmother, which got him into a bit of trouble with his family. He spent 3 months in the next slide in hospitals. One of his love affairs was with the nurse, that's the hospital. Next slide, he met somebody who's mentioned quite often in the letters and quite often in the story of his life, Baxter, who'd been in the army for about 30 years in the regiment, the Master Fusiliers. He'd been in the South African War. He was the quartermaster. This time he was 1915, he was a captain, became a major. Baxter was standing beside him when he died and wrote a very moving letter to my grandmother. Later on we'll show you that. So, next slide, in France, he was transport officer for about 30 months for the 1st Battalion. They were in the 29th Division when they went to France, that soon transferred to the 16th Irish Division, and then later on in 1918 they moved to the 57th Division. He experienced many highs and lows of that battalion's wartime activities, both with that battalion, the regiment, and these divisions. He was mentioned in dispatches. How they issued those, one's never quite sure. One sometimes feel that they just dish them out by it's your turn to be mentioned in dispatches, or whether he did some daring deeds, it's not up for me to say. But we have the letter from Winston Churchill, Minister of War, announcing that he got mentioned in dispatches after he was killed. Well, he met Doris, the next slide, he met Doris, my grandmother, on his first leave from France. And she was the daughter of a solicitor. He courted her by letter, wrote daily to each other, and married her on a sick leave in April 1917, gave her measles on their honeymoon, which didn't go down too well. Spent all in all of their married life 40 days together. Kind of amazing story, really. He had a nickname. George is his name. His fellow officers sometimes called him George. Bubby, his wife called him Bubby from Herbert. Obviously, it was his baby name, Bubby. And other officers called him Anna, short for Anaheim. Doris Hookway, his future wife, she was a sort of flapper girl, really. You can see her there, actually, wearing the master's badge that she was very proud of. He sent back one of his cap badges from the front. Daughter of a middle-class solicitor. She was 20 years old, a bit of a flapper. Next slide, you'll see what she was like when she was 17. She was quite a proficient roller skater in those days. She was a singer, concert pianist, and in later life, when I knew her, she ran a ballet dancing school until she was about 70 years old in the town of Bath, where her family came from, as it is. They wrote daily, the next slide, thanks, Adrian, containing pictures, cuttings, sketches, love stories, amazingly intimate stuff. And the next slide shows one of the cuttings they would send to each other. He wrote down here, you can't read it, he just says, on my next leave in August, it will be about love, not war. Because by this time he realized that having a lovely girl in his life was very important to him, and he just wanted the war to finish so he could become a bank manager, go back to live in a cottage and start a family. Well, now about his job. So this evening I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the chapters of the book which are more to do with the monsters of the war. Transport of Delight, you know that comes from a famous hymn, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. And there's this line in it saying Transport of Delight. And he loved his job as a transport officer. So there are other chapters in the book about how he wanted to be a pilot at one time. It was too heavy to be a pilot in the Royal Flying Corps. Days of leave and days of love, and then all the stories about his Egyptian escapades. I'm going to skip those tonight. I'm just going to pick out a few things that you might be interested in. So he loved his job, and I'm going to read now from some of the letters. So the next slide, Adrian, and we'll just read from that. He writes to Doris saying, I've had rather a worrying evening. As I sent out a limber out this afternoon, it didn't come back until 11 p.m. The driver was drunk and the brakeman very nearly, and of course it's jolly dark about here. Fortunately, the animals knew their way back. These are not the same men I found having parked their wagon outside a local estaminet last week. They were not there for a cup of coffee, as they claimed, because the place had a red lamp outside. Now, as well as plodding my way up to the trenches and getting back at 3 a.m., I still had to organise a disciplining meeting for early in the morning for the men on report. Generally, all these men are fine chaps, but give them an inch, well, you know. Bad news, too. There's talk of the transport officers going back to the battalion as regular company officers and getting the ASC to do the work. It's awful. I don't mind going back to the trenches, but I do mind losing all my horses, and especially Doris too. It's bad luck, but it may not take place. Yesterday was a terrible day, as three generals came round my lines. Oh, oops, dearie. Red tabs, all of them. but none could find any fault. Of course they couldn't. Today, one of my wagon drivers had a smash-up with a car, smashing two wheels of the car and the axle. I had to explain the accident in writing, and on an army form, of course, the only thing to do was to tell a lot of lies because I want my man to get off. You do have to be a jack-of-all-trades out here, builder, vet, lawyer, mechanic, marksman, and the rest. Talking of being a mechanic, my friend and I drove into the nearest village in a galloping wagon, which belongs to me. It's a delightful French wagonette, which was found in Luce some time ago. I've had it painted and done up, so it's the pride of the regiment. I wanted to christen it, and so put on 2 miles to the village. Halfway back, the blooming wheel came off and careered down the road. After an hour of mechanical work, we fixed it so the men could take it back to the lines. Just as the boss started shelling their infernal shelling. If I get any trouble from my fellow officers, I will set them up for the wheel to come off 10 miles away. So the army tried to replace him, but he, as a transport officer, but it never did actually, throughout the war. His battalion and the regiment always had their own dedicated transport officer, and they didn't leave it to the ASC. Now, he wrote to his future father-in-law, a really